Okay, everyone, welcome back to our DIGA overview here. And let's again now look at how you teachers can use this. How can they create groups? Again, you go back to My Library, and it shows you all your documents that maybe you've highlighted. I have a few here for examples for you. I have not used this with my students yet. I played with this a lot a little bit last end of last year, so I didn't really create class groups and class sets. But say you want to actually do this. You have this great thing here called the teacher console. All right, so you go up here. Once you sign up for DIGO, you can apply for a teacher account. It's free. It will take a few days for them to clear your email address. But once you have your teacher account, this is great. You can now create classes. So I was just fooling around. So now I create a group for my class, and you basically give the group a name. Okay, you can give its own unique URL. Okay. And then you can add a description, and then you decide who can view it. Now, for teaching, I would certainly want you to do private. Only group members can view the content. Then you just create your group. So once you have a group, this example, my fifth period APUS class, one member now is me, I can add members. Okay, and how do you add members? There's a lot of ways you can do it. If you have the students' email addresses, you could just put those right into them. You can have basically, if students already have their own account, they can be added this way, or you can invite students. This is probably the easiest way. All right, and that's really, really great. So now you invite them to join your class, and now the members will add as they add to their, as they add to your account. This is kind of back up here. You can manage members. Once you have members, you can delete them. Right now, I'm only the only member, but you can see how many things they post. You could ban this member. You can moderate all their posts first before they actually, post something. So there's a lot of sort of user control over this, okay, which I think is really, really helpful. Now, why would you want to do this? Again, as we go back to our library here, we go back to the DIGO main page, okay. Oh, this is what it looks like before you register. Okay. But anyway, if I go to my account, okay, let me go back to my, I want to go back to my teacher. I want to go back to my page here. Hold on one second. Oh, I'm my library. I apologize. Here we go. Okay, and here's all your posts and things of that nature. Again, let's just open this one up. Two more annotations. Remember, I can now basically edit things. Let's go back to that document. Remember this one? This post by reference to God? Well, let's make sure the post is added to my group, APUS05, and I post it. Okay? I could add some more to it. Okay, so it's already edited. So now once this is added to a class, you'll see as a teacher, and everybody in the class will see what this student posted, basically what document they shared and what comments they added to the document. Okay? So this is great for assigning students documents, for a class to sort of mark up documents together, to share their annotations together. I think there's a lot of possibilities with this. I think once you get into the product and you play with it, you experiment with it with your students, you'll really see some of the great value to this. So again, on the other side here, you have all your things that you've saved. The idea is that DIGL wants you to use this as your archive of research. So if you're doing any kind of research, any kind of document, any kind of topic, you save your documents in the DIGL library because it's really cool. Let me just show you here. Say I'll take out Washington Post article, whatever the case may be. We'll just find some sort of general article. Great for a government class. I'm trying to find something that's kind of easy here. Let's just go to maybe, I don't know, politics, and we'll see what's going on in the world of politics. All right. So whatever. This article about border control and border reform. Maybe you're doing some research. Here it is. Now you want to annotate this, right? So the same thing. You go to your DIGO. Up here, D, you do your annotations, you save it, you bookmark it, okay? And you have all these things. You have some more options here, too. Now, so let's just annotate some things real quick. Okay, we'll annotate it. It's already bookmarked. We'll add a sticky note. Just quickly, example. Going to share with my group, my class. If I was a student, I post it. This is all great, 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 great stuff. I also then can now, this is really cool. You can share the page. Now, I didn't show you this yet. So you can share this. You can actually share through email, Google, Twitter, Facebook, certainly, but annotated link. This is a link that basically now you can share with other people, and this was a link that would bring them to the website, but not just the plain website, but the annotated website. That's really cool. All right, so it shows you that. So you can share links. All right, if you go back to your Diggo, you can also cached version. You can press cached version, and basically it will save this page forever. So say the Washington Post takes that page down, you know, it's an old article or the case may be. All right, it doesn't matter. This article now is saved in your library forever. Now, something's wrong right now. Sorry. But the caching is really cool. But again, they want it you have the, you know, upgrade to the, you know, paid version. So let's talk about that. So what are some of the options here? So let's go to the Diggo home. Okay, and let's talk about what are some of the pricing. So this is all about Diggo and how it evolved and things of that nature. All right, so you know, educator accounts, you want to click that. That's how you get your educator account. All right, which is really, 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 really good. All right, and some other aspects here, but you can see if you really want to upgrade it to the paid version. I'm trying to find their pricing here again. I don't remember where their pricing was. Apologize here. So I click Go Premium. It explains the pricing here. Okay, so the basic for beginners is $20 a year. Unlimited bookmarks, unlimited highlights, full text. All right, and ads are free. Premium, you get cache pages, unlimited screen captures, and better support. All right, so again, depends on read through this, depends on what you really want to do with this, but I think there's a lot with the free version that makes this a really attractive product. All right, so hope you found this helpful. Thank you for watching and for listening, and have a great day.